Professor Swaminathan, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm truly honored to be here. I'm just going to tell you a small story. This is a story of simple ideas, of how seemingly simple ideas can transform institutions, of how capacities latent in grassroots institutions can be channelized for common good. This is a story of how the impact of decisive and visionary leadership can lead to long-term changes in institutions by making simple changes in practices and procedures. This is a story of convergence between two paradigms of development: the dominant interventionist paradigm and the decentralized participative paradigm, of how these two paradigms can be synthesized, harmonized, brought together by making the best out of both. This is a story that revolves around two themes, NEEM and Urea. It has benefited tens of thousands of rural people, especially women, and has the potential of benefiting millions more. Urea, as we all know, is one of the most popular fertilizers in the world. More than 100 million farmers use 31 million tons of urea, which is produced by 26 urea production companies, 24 million tons, and the rest is imported. 70% of variable cost of urea is oil and gas. It takes about $250 to make one ton of urea. But urea is sold at a price of just $85 to $90. And this price differential historically has been one of the greatest attractions for diversion of urea. There was a time urea was getting diverted for making a formaldehyde for production of laminates. There was a time urea was getting diverted for making of CPC blue for production of industrial dyes and dyestuff, for making of cattle feed, fish feed, poultry feed. And there was also a time urea was getting used and getting diverted for such innovative and horrendous usages like thickening of milk. And the time I am referring to, ladies and gentlemen, is not a distant past. It was just 3 years back. But all that has stopped, all that is past, and all that is history. Because of a historical decision taken by the Honorable Prime Minister of India that all urea being produced and being imported to the country shall be coated with neem oil. Each and every gram of urea in this country shall be coated hereinafter with neem oil. And that has completely stopped the diversion of urea. Not only that, it has increased the efficiency of urea, because the neem oil coating reduces the process of nitrification and more urea is available for a greater length of time in the soil. And the country has saved almost $1 billion by reduction in imports of urea during last 1 year. Just to give you a perspective again, India consumes 31 million tons of urea, and to coat that quantity of urea at the rate of almost 800 grams per ton of urea, we require about 26,000 tons of neem oil. And for production of that quantity of neem oil, we require about 400,000 tons of neem seeds. And for collecting that quantity of neem seeds, we require about 16 million neem trees. After this policy mandate, GNFC, like any other company in the fertilizer sector, could have gone the traditional way of purchasing neem oil from the market, which was infested by unscrupulous brokers and middlemen who were selling all kinds of oils topped up with as a directant powder as neem oil. But GNFC chose to tread a path that was less taken. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. GNFC embarked on a massive process of backward integration, while simultaneously creating shared values with a special focus on empowerment of women by creating additional income generation and additional employment generation opportunities for them and thereby improving their livelihood prospects. And that brings us to the genesis of NEEM project, which is a successful business model for creating what Professor Michael Eugene Porter of Harvard Business School has called shared values. And the four pillars of GNFC NEEM project are sourcing, storage, extraction, quality control, and forward integration. NEEM, as we all know, is not a commercial tree. NEEM is not poplar. NEEM is not olive. NEEM doesn't grow on farms and can't be harvested in bulk from farms. NEEM grows in my courtyard, in your backyard, in a front yard, here, there, and everywhere. How do we collect that quantity of neem seeds, just large quantities of neem seeds, to production to produce neem oil has been one of the biggest logistic challenges which we solved by creating a vast network of almost 4,000 village level collection centers catering to almost 5,000 villages of Gujarat, leveraging all kinds of community structures, be it self-help group of women, be it village cooperative societies, be it milk cooperative societies, NGOs, and so on and so forth. We also created another layer of almost 300 service provider partners for various activities like screening, weighing, bagging, storage, transportation, and ultimately, and most importantly, for regular payments to these women. The idea was that a woman doesn't have to walk more than a kilometer after collecting neem seeds 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours in the evening. Otherwise, if she doesn't get her payments regularly, she will lose interest in the whole operation. We also identified a number of expeller units depending on the areas of storage, because transportation was an important constituent of the economics of all operations. And ultimately, we also set up an expeller, an extraction unit within the battery limits of our company. We also integrated the entire activity with existing programs of agricultural extension catering to almost 5,000 villages, conducted hundreds of trainings for these seed collectors, village level collection centers, and SPPs, creating large scale awareness and consciousness generation. And the results have been astounding. In 3 years, 45,000 tons of neem seeds collection, 4.5 crore kilos, to give you a perspective, benefiting 4.5 lakh women and more than 2 lakh other people who were involved in all kinds of ancillary activities. We calculated that for managing an operation of 10,000 tons of neem seeds, we required 24,000 people for loading, unloading, bagging, rebagging, and storage. Now that was the kind of additional employment generation that was created, generated, and an additional income generation of almost $7 million to these people. But most importantly, an 8-fold rise in the price of neem seeds that these women were paid, from rupees 150 paise, 2 rupees, to almost 16 rupees. When GNFC entered in the market, we paid as high as 16 rupees per kilogram, depending on the quality of neem seeds being brought by these women. And the money directly went to the women, and it benefited them. After the success of our backward integration model, we were emboldened, encouraged to roll out a forward integration model. To give you a perspective, in the very first year, we produced almost 810 tons of neem oil. And as a urea producer, we require about 550 tons of neem oil for coating the quantity of urea that we produce. We were left with an excess of 250 tons of neem oil, and what to do with that oil? And the first thing that came to my mind was neem soap. We did a lot of laboratory testing and learning in soap making. I personally did. And we realized that soap picking is not really a rocket science. A soap essentially is a combination of various kinds of oils. 20% of coconut oil, 20% of mauda oil, 20% of palm oil, and the rest is caustic with a little bit of fragrance by the name of which the soap is sold. If it is sandalwood soap, a dash of sandalwood fragrance. If it is rose soap, a dash of rose fragrance. We also conducted a market survey of the entire spectrum of neem soaps available in the market, from Margo to Medimix and from Beers to Patanjali. And to our surprise, we realized that many of them were not using neem oil at all. They were using neem extract, which is very different in therapeutic characteristics than neem oil. And most of them were using neem oil from 0.1% to 3%. And ladies and gentlemen, we decided that we will make a neem soap with 21% of content of neem oil. And we did that. And this, I can claim very confidently, is the best neem soap ever made and marketed in India. With 21% content of neem oil, it is the most therapeutic neem soap ever made anywhere in this country. We didn't stop at that only. We started making neem hand wash, neem face wash, neem shampoo, neem hair oil we have introduced. And now, very recently, we have also introduced neem-based mosquito repellent, neem night. So ladies and gentlemen, all of these operations are being conducted, being operated by women. The idea is to generate more and more employment and more additional income to women. Each soap, we have written it in the box of the soap, you're helping rural women to earn livelihood by buying this soap. But in any case, this is a very successful business model. The whole thing is picking up now. Now, we are expanding our network of operations. Just 2 months back, we were selling at 4,000 shops. Now we are selling at 21,000 shops. We have converged with various bulk marketing channels like Central Defense Canteens, Central Police Canteens, Gujarat State Civil Supplies Corporation, Khadi and Village Industries Commission. Soon our neem soap and other neem products will be sold through Khadi Bhandars. So the whole marketing is gradually expanding and people are picking up. We are also establishing neem stores, dedicated neem stores in state of Gujarat. We are targeting various gardens in metropolitan cities of Gujarat where Amul parlors have been opened. And next to Amul parlors, we are opening up neem parlors. That is how the entire marketing is being planned. But the idea, the objective, the purpose, the goal is empowerment. And in the process, the business has also been growing. So the neem project, ladies and gentlemen, is innovative. Neem seeds collection, to be honest, has never been part of any rural development, employment generation, or additional income generation program of any kind anywhere in India so far. So this is innovative. It is community-led and it is integrational. The whole model now by now has been well established. Right from the bottom of the pyramid, the individual seed collectors, the village level collection centers, the SPPs, down to the company. It's absolutely transparent, it's institutionalized, and it's been functioning very well for the last 3 years. The Government of India, through Ministry of Fertilizer, through Prime Minister's office, has directed all the fertilizer companies to adopt and replicate NEEM project. And due to that, we have been expanding in other states. During the last 2 years, we have expanded apart from Gujarat to 4 more states. Rajasthan, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh. This year we're going to go to Uttar Pradesh in a very big way. And the ladies have been welcoming this project like anything. We have been holding various kinds of consciousness generation and awareness generation meetings in UP presently. And we have been getting tremendous response even from rural areas of Uttar Pradesh. The UNDP conducted a massive survey. in 4 districts of Gujarat, 19 talukas and 129 villages, covering more than 2,000 women, and also focused group discussions. And the results have been very encouraging. There has been a 58% rise in the annual income of these women who have been involved in NEEM seeds collection. There has been an increased control on assets and decision-making within the family of these women. 98% of women are happy in being associated with NEEM project. There has been a substantial increase in their expenditure on health, education. Seasonal migration has reduced because this coincides with lean activity, lean agricultural activity just before the monsoon. So migration has reduced. But the most important and fascinating finding to me has been that in many of these homes, the incidence of domestic violence has reduced. And this goes hand in hand with global and local studies that economic emancipation goes hand in hand with social emancipation. There have been many success stories of women who have involved themselves. Manjula Ben, she stays in an outlandish village in the tribal area of Gujarat, Bharuj district. She involved herself in the very first season, collected loads and loads of neem seeds and earned almost 15,000 rupees. Purchased a buffalo, also purchased a vegetable cart, started selling milk, earning about 50 rupees a day, started selling vegetables and got really busy. When my people went for the second year pre-season activities, she meets them and tells them, look, I'm very busy this season, but I have 5 neem trees in my courtyard. I would like to lease them out. Now that is empowerment. That is how this project has empowered them for bargaining. There's another lady, Amisha Ben. She runs a self-help group of almost 190 women. They collected loads and loads of neem seeds, collected almost 12 lakh rupees, invested part of that income in a papad making unit. Amisha Ben comes to me one day with 3-4 big packets of papad as a gift. And she tells me, sir, we have collected neem seeds for you. You are running 3 big canteens catering to almost 2,500 people. Why don't you purchase papad from us? Now that is entrepreneurship. That is real empowerment. So the NEEM project has converted landless laborers into wage earners and wage earners into rural entrepreneurs. So ladies and gentlemen, we are standing at the cusp of a NEEM revolution in this country. With a requirement of almost 26,000 tons of NEEM oil, necessitating collection of 400,000 tons of NEEM seeds, we have a potential of generating additional income for almost 6 million rural people and a whole growth of ancillary industries. And that is what the Honorable Prime Minister has called a win-win situation for all the stakeholders. Thank you.